As far as chemical reactions go, none are quite as altogether beautiful, useful, and dangerous as fire. Fires require three things to come together: a fuel source, heat, and oxygen. While you're probably familiar with most things that can catch fire, like wood or gas, there are some everyday materials with unexpectedly fiery properties. And since a lot of them are found in our homes, knowing about them might even keep you safe. So here's five weirdly flammable things. To create fire, you need a lot of heat to gain enough kinetic energy for molecules from the fuel source to break their interactions and transition to the gas phase. Those molecules can then react with oxygen in the surrounding air in a process called oxidation. The oxidation process then releases even more heat, which helps free more molecules from the fuel to react with oxygen in a self-sustaining chain reaction we call fire. The heat and light released from that process make up the familiar visible flames we see in burning objects. The minimum temperature at which all this can happen is called the flash point, and different materials have different flash points. Anything that has a flash point of 37.8 degrees Celsius and upwards is considered combustible, such as wood and paper. That's because they take some work to light on fire since their flash point is way above room temperature. On the other hand, things with flash points closer to room temperature, like alcohols, are called flammable because they can evaporate quickly and their fumes can catch fire. So, in general, the lower the flash point, the more easily something can be set on fire. And something that can catch fire easily, although it has a pretty high flash point, is plain old flour, like the kind used to make bread. While it seems simple and harmless, as far as cooking ingredients go, in the right circumstances, flour is pretty explosive. The main component of flour is starch, which is a carbohydrate. The molecules in a carbohydrate contain lots of energetic bonds between atoms of carbon and hydrogen. Oxidation can release the energy in those bonds, making them easy to burn. When it's all lumped together in a pile, flour isn't especially likely to catch fire. But when it's dispersed in the air, like a cloud of dust, that's a whole different story. That's because the individual grains of flour are small, giving them a high surface area relative to their size. So when they're suspended in the air, they have access to lots of oxygen surrounding them, making it even easier to burn. What's more, because those grains are so small, they burn up really fast and light up nearby grains in the process, spreading the fire way quicker than it would in a single lumpy fuel source. So if a spark or nearby flame catches part of a floury dust cloud, it can set the whole thing alight. In 2015, that exact scenario happened at a water park in northern Taiwan. A celebration involving bursts of colored cornflour turned into a fireball that injured hundreds of people. Thankfully, most cooking recipes that include flour involve getting it wet with water, making it much less dangerous in the kitchen. But even so, it pays to be careful when throwing bags of flour around any flames, like a stove. The same goes for other powdery foods, like powdered coffee creamers, too. And fire risks aren't limited to stuff in the kitchen, either. Many nail polish removers and other household stain removers contain a key ingredient: acetone. Acetone is great at dissolving things like nail polish and can easily be washed away with water. That combination naturally makes it great at removing stains, but unfortunately, acetone, as you probably guessed, has another property. It's really flammable. Its flash point is at negative 18 degrees Celsius, making it easy to set alight. And like flour, its molecules have similar carbon-hydrogen bonds that release lots of energy during oxidation. Finally, acetone molecules don't interact as strongly with each other in liquid form, so they have a tendency to evaporate from the surface. In other words, it's pretty volatile. That's why nail polish remover has such a strong and distinct smell, since the acetone floats easily into the air as a vapor. And as we saw for flour, when small, tiny bits of material float around, it makes them much easier to set on fire. In fact, people have gotten seriously hurt applying nail polish remover near open sources of flames like candles, since acetone vapor can set alight very quickly. So if you're going to use nail polish remover on a quiet night in, safety officials recommend you don't have any candles nearby. In other cases, certain materials themselves might not be combustible or flammable, but can still cause a fire. Glass doesn't burn very well at all, but it can still turn into a secret arsonist under the right conditions. This time, the culprit is the physics of glass, rather than its chemistry. When light interacts with a dense but transparent material, like glass, it effectively gets slowed down. And because of that, if a ray of light approaches that material at an angle to its surface, the path of that ray is also bent away from the surface as it travels through it. Physicists describe this as Snell's law. So if you have a curved piece of glass, like a lens, it can focus lots of incoming slamming rays of light into a small spot called a focal point. That's how magnifying glasses work, using Snell's law. The light comes from a wide field of view, but narrows down to a spot where we can see it if we align it with our eyes. Magnifying glasses can also focus a distant, bright light source, like the sun, to a spot where a lot of the heat and light gets concentrated to a single point. And much like a lens, curved pieces of glass, like snow globes, flower vases, mirrors, and even some windows, can produce a similar kind of effect. It can also just so happen that a combustible or flammable material might happen to align with the effective focal point of that glass and be set on fire. Fires have been caused by objects like mirrors sitting near windowsills in people's homes. On a large scale, the effect can be even more dramatic. In 2013, a curvy building in London made of glass melted part of a car on a nearby street as it reflected the sun's rays, which happened for around 2 hours a day, so the building had to be retrofitted with sunshades so it could stop melting things. So it might be a good idea to keep crystal flower vases, bottles of water, and mirrors away from the windowsill. So far, we've talked about things catching fire when they receive heat from some other source. But there are strange instances where the fuel itself can generate enough heat to basically set itself on fire. Linseed oil is made from flax seeds, and it's often used on wooden furniture to protect it and make grain patterns in the wood more visible. At first, it might not be all that surprising that linseed oil can catch fire, since, well, lots of oils can be burned. But in the right conditions, linseed oil can basically set itself on fire because of the way it dries. Most liquids dry by evaporating off water or some other solvent in the mixture and leaving the rest behind. But linseed oil dries through oxidation, basically the same process through which you create fire. That doesn't mean that it bursts into flames immediately, since there's normally not enough heat to make the reaction self-sustaining. But as linseed oil dries through oxidation, it generates heat. And if it gets hot enough, it can set itself on fire. That's especially problematic since people apply linseed oil to furniture by rubbing it in with pieces of cloth, and then when they're done with the cloths, they often throw them into a pile. As the oil in the pile of cloth dries, the cloths heat up, and their collective heat can increase until the oil and cloths catch fire. In 2014, a pile of linseed-soaked cloths was identified as the source of a fire in a home in Maryland. In fact, in 1991, a whole high-rise tower in Philadelphia caught on fire for the same reason. So if you do use linseed oil to spruce up your furniture, safety officials recommend you wash the rags you use and hang them out where there's lots of airflow before storing. Finally, there's an object that really doesn't seem like it should be flammable, but burns incredibly easily. Ping pong balls. Specifically, older ping pong balls are surprisingly flammable. A few people have noticed this and speculated that it's because there was a gas that was put into the balls during manufacturing that burns really well, but to be clear, it's just ordinary air in there. It's the actual material of the balls, which is called celluloid, that burns really well. Until about 2020, ping pong balls were still being made of that stuff, since it's a light and durable plastic that gave the balls the right properties for being whacked about. Although it has a high flash point of over 175 degrees Celsius, once celluloid hits that point, it can start burning without needing a spark or flame to get started, and it burns really easily. Celluloid gets its ignitable properties from a substance called nitrocellulose, which was used as a replacement for gunpowder in weapons during the 1800s. By the middle of the century, American entrepreneurs discovered that dipping nitrocellulose in wax turned it into a hard, enduring substance and patented it as celluloid, which was one of the first manufactured plastics. Celluloid enjoyed a long stint in lots of applications, famously including rolls of film like the kind used in projectors. Unfortunately, when the lamp and the projectors got hot, they had the tendency to make the celluloid film dramatically burst into flames. Because of its flammable tendencies, celluloid fell out of use in most cases, though ping pong balls were the exception until 2014, when they started to be phased out because of the fire risks of transporting lots of balls around. But older ping pong balls are still made of celluloid, so you probably want to keep them away from any sources of flame. And celluloid hasn't totally disappeared either. It's still used to make, amongst other things, guitar picks. But thankfully, as far as we know, there haven't been any unintentional fires caused by guitar picks, so for now, there's nothing to fret about. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow. If you enjoyed it, you might enjoy becoming a member of our channel. Channel members can submit questions to our QQ inbox or see exclusive behind-the-scenes photos. If you're interested, you can get started by clicking the join button below this video.